Hey guys, welcome back. My name is Allie if you're new, and welcome to Beauty with a Purpose. So if you are new to my channel, my name is Allie. I upload 3 videos a week, beauty, Bible, and lifestyle. So if any of those interest you, please go ahead and hit that subscribe button and let's get into today's video. So for today's video, I have for you guys a Shop My Stash chit chat get ready with me. As always, we're just going to be chatting, catching up. And so let's go ahead and get into picking out the makeup so we can start chatting. All right, you guys. So as always, starting in this drawer, you know, I haven't used these two primers in a while. So let's go ahead and use those. I have been obsessed with these two concealers, so we're not going to use those. We're going to try to find something else. Ooh, you know which one I never use is this e.l.f. Flawless Brightening Concealer. But for my brows, one I have not used in a while is the Ordinary Concealer, so I'm gonna use that to clean up my brows. And then for foundation, we're not gonna use that. Ugh, but I need something my shade. Okay, so all of these are way too light for me, so I can literally only pick between these three here. So I'm gonna use the Pretty Fresh one because I've actually been using the Pretty Natural one quite a bit. Okay, so now for cream products and a setting powder. So for the setting powder, I've been obsessed with my e.l.f. one, but let's try out this Tarte Shape Tape one because I'm about to do a declutter and I want to see if I like that enough to keep it. Okay, and then for cream products, I'm breathing so hard. Let's use the Yinsa bronzer. For highlighter, I haven't used this one in a while. And then for blush, I think I rarely use this Kaja one. For bronzer, blush, and highlight. So I got this in my BoxyCharm for July. And so I think I'm gonna use this for bronzer. I think I've only used it one time. And then I got this in my Ipsy. So let's go ahead and use this for blush and highlighter. So for eyeshadow, what do we wanna use? I really want to do something cool toned, kind of cool toned. Let's use this Natasha Denona palette. I haven't used this, but let's use my favorite eyeshadow primer. All right, we're going to move all of this to my table really fast. All right, now coming to this side, you guys already know, so. First of all, let's use the Bambi Eye Mascara. Why won't this focus? That's my lash glue. And then I did get this in an Ipsy as well. This is the Lauren Conrad eyeliner. I'm gonna use that. What is this? Wow, I haven't even used this. I don't know where this came from. Let's use that. I haven't even used that. For brow gel. Use the e.l.f. Brow Wow. I haven't used that in such a long time. And then for actual brows, what have I not used in forever? I haven't used this in forever. Or my Wonder Beauty Brow Pencil. For lashes. So anything that's not in the front is going to be super dramatic, but you know what? I haven't used my Salon Perfect 614s in like forever, so let's use those. For lips, I want something nice and nude, also glossy. So, wait, is this a gloss? That's a gloss. So that goes on that lip. Let's use ColourPop Sunnyside with my NYX lip liner in brown, if I can find it. There it is, NYX lip liner in brown. And then let's use this for priming and setting. time to put on some makeup. Okay, so now that the makeup's picked out, let's go ahead and put this headband on. And you guys saw everything we picked out, so I'm just gonna start applying the makeup and chatting. Oh, that's so tight on my head. I have a big head. So we're gonna, nothing's changed about my routine or anything like that. So we're starting off with primer. So you guys, let's state the obvious because I have not filmed. Unless you follow me on Instagram or Snapchat, you wouldn't know, but I did get braces. I got them July 9th. I only got my tops on. I go in next month, August 11th or August 17th. I want to say August 17th. I think I go August 17th to get my bottom ones put on, and I'm so nervous because it took me literally from August 9th probably till about, July 9th up until about July 18th to even get used to them just being in my mouth and not feel like they're constantly poking the back of my mouth. And so I think my mouth has just built up some tough skin back there at this point. But yeah, I finally got my braces and I'm so excited. Your girl's teeth been on the struggle bus her whole life. Her whole life. Y'all, I was just bullied for everything. I was bullied for my freckles. I was bullied for being a little chunkier. I was bullied for my crooked teeth. At one point, I was even bullied for being mixed because, I don't know, I guess black girls just didn't like it. Just so crazy because now they want everybody to be on their side. And I'm like, y'all have been mean to everybody else for like so long. Not all black girls, but at least the black girls I was surrounded by in middle school and high school. Okay, so outside of braces, let's talk about a couple of other things. Going in with brows. Sorry, one of my best friends called me. And so I'm going in with the Natasha Denona palette. Now I already primed, finished up my eyes and stuff. So I'm going to set down my lid with this one right here. But I was going to start talking about how Brian and I have decided to cut back on a lot of stuff. So I will not be getting Ipsy anymore. I will not be getting BoxyCharm anymore. Brian was getting a subscription box called Muscle Box. He's not going to be getting that anymore. We paid off our car back in May, and so that saved us $400 on top of all the boxes. That's another $90 that we saved. And like, we just cut back on, and we canceled our gym membership. And so we're saving about a total of $200 a month, but it also like balanced itself out with me getting my braces, cause that's gonna be $200 a month. Yeah, and everything, like we just decided to cut back. We're trying to be better with our spending. We're trying to be better with just being adults and understanding that, you know, like, having all of the extra stuff is nice, having, you know, like the gym membership, but if we can spend a little bit of money now and buy and buy a bench and buy like a $100 treadmill and buy dumbbells and basically just buy it over time, and we still wouldn't even spend as much in a year as we do on a gym membership. Like, that's just wiser. And so that's what we decided to do. And so, yeah, we're just, we've been eating at home a lot more too. Part of that is due to our new diet and eating habits, because, and I'm doing what I eat in a day. So Saturday, my what I eat in a day will be up. So if you want a lot of info on that, you guys can watch that video. But I decided to change my eating habits because my weight loss was not moving. I was at a standstill. I plateaued. And so I decided to switch things up. And so it requires me to eat at home more often because, for one, I wanted more clean ingredients. So more organic ingredients, if you will. And so I don't know what a lot of restaurants put in their food and stuff. I'd say I've eaten out three times since I've started my new diet, and it's still tracking all my calories and everything like that. And it hits hard when I think the healthiest thing that was Chick-fil-A, and I ate grilled nuggets and one of their fruit bowls because I just didn't want a salad. Like, I got braces, lettuce gets stuck in there. I mean, my food had ended up getting stuck in there anyways, but salad gets really, really stuck in there. But yeah, so just we're eating out less. That saves a ton of money because, I mean, we're a family of five 90% of the time. And so, and I say that because sometimes Ethan will be with his dad, or sometimes we'll have little Brian. And so 90% of the time, like, we're a family of five, and eating out can get expensive really, really fast. So yeah, we've decided to cut back just to save a lot more money. Not only that, but the boys are starting school on the 11th of August. And so school supplies, uniforms, shoes, just making sure they have everything that they need. So it's kind of like we cut back, but right now we're still spending what we cut back on. But I mean, it's okay because it's not going to last forever. We're not going to have to spend like this forever. Yeah. Also, I finally went to a chiropractor. If you follow me for a while, you would know that I suffered from really, really bad back pain. And sitting down filming used to kill me. Sitting down editing used to kill me. That's why I upgraded my chair in the first place. But even that wasn't doing everything that I needed it to do. And so I finally went to a chiropractor. Turns out my hips were all the way shifted to the left. So my right leg was actually shorter than my left leg due to the fact that my hips were shifting to the left. So my left side was bearing all my weight, and like, my body was just not in line, which was also causing my spine to go like that. So, you know, your spine's supposed to go up and down. Well, from my tailbone, my spine has a curve in it. And not only that, but my spine is also severely compressed, which usually you need surgery for. But thank goodness I ended up at a chiropractor where they do decompression therapy. So now I'm going through that as well as just getting adjusted from time to time. And I already feel so much better. My back pain, I'll be sore like after my decompression therapy or whatever, but it only lasts a few minutes, and then I'm fine the rest of the time. So yeah, I just a lot of different things. Also, I've been really, really wanting to get my nails done, my feet done. So I spent about $50 on Amazon, which, mind you, is the price of either one pedicure or one gel manicure, which is what I get anyways because I don't really like long nails. And so I spent that and got me like a gel manicure set. I got me a little pedicure set, like not the little like foot soaker thing, but like the foot scrapers and the foot file things. And we saved money doing that. Like I said, we're spending a lot of money right now so that we can save money in the long run, and I am perfectly okay with that because it's better than just constantly spending, trying to fit in things that I like to pamper myself. So yeah, seems like we're spending a lot right now, but it's because we're trying to save in the long run. Like, we're buying things to save us in the long run. It could be different if we were just buying all these things and like I was still gonna go get my nails done, or we were still gonna have a gym membership, you know? And so, like, really now the only things that we're spending extra money on are, like, my decompression therapy for my back and my braces. And, I mean, that's health-wise. So, and even that is still cheaper than all the things that we cut back on. So, we're really not spending that much at all. Maybe $275 and we're saving about $500 a month. So, we're saving a lot more than we're spending still. Now that lashes are on, liners on, mascara is on, let's go ahead and get back into chit-chatting. Going in with foundation now. So, I already forgot what I was talking about. Oh no, we were talking about saving money. So yeah, we decided to cut back just on a lot of stuff. It wasn't like we were struggling or anything like that. We just want to be more financially smart, more financially prepared, and to just to feel comfortable without the extra spending. Like, Brian and I, we started out broke. Like, when I say broke, I mean barely had money to buy groceries. And so for us, all the extra spending, like, it doesn't bother us to not do it, you know. And the spending that we are doing now is that we're making sure that the spending that we do is either quality time as a family or quality time with one another for our marriage, or just, you know, like, being a blessing to somebody else. That's really what we want to save for, is, you know, for others who might be in need and need help and things like that that are around us, like our church body, our church family, friends, things like that, just family in general. You just never know. And as well as, it's always good to have at least $500 in your savings account, because $500 can cover a lot of different things. You have a blowout unexpectedly, you break your phone, you need to get the screen repaired, just so many things. Broken washer, you can go buy a new washer for $500. Like, so $500 can cover so many things in case of an emergency, that it's just good to have it in the savings account. And so we're just really trying to, like, save more, and then also be better prepared, because we are still going to try to buy a house in May next year. It was just way too hard right now. The housing market is crazy where we live. I'm pretty sure it's crazy everywhere, but it's, like, insane here. Like, we were over offering on houses, and here come all these people with their California money trying to make Texas liberal. It's a whole nother topic for another day. Anyways, trying to just, and they would come in with their cash offers, and I'm just like, dude, it's not like Brian and I were going through, like, Rocket Mortgage or Quicken Loans. Like we went through a bank. Like, our money was guaranteed. Like, it was there. And I'm just like, dude, like, you'd rather take a cash offer now and get less money rather than just go through the process and have more money. Like, the money's gonna be the same regardless. And I just didn't get it. And it was getting really frustrating and really discouraging. So I was like, you know what? Let's just back down. Let's just wait a year. And we'll revisit this situation again then. And Brian was like, okay, I completely agree. And so, yeah, that's what we're doing. We're saving. We're going to be better prepared. Pay down some more of our debts. And because a lot of people don't tell you, but a lot of the time, it's not only your credit score that affects you getting a house. It has a lot to do with your debt to income ratio. So how much debt you have based on how much money you're bringing in a year plays a big role on whether or not you get approved, how much you do get approved for, like, so many other things than just your credit score. And I wish Brian and I knew that, because we've just been so focused on fixing our credit score that we weren't even thinking about, like, the cars that we had on our name. Like, even though our credit scores were good, we still technically had debt because we hadn't paid off our black car, and now we have the black truck and that we're making payments on. And so we didn't know that, you know what I mean? And then also in Texas, even if only he's the one on the deed, Texas does, and you're married, like Texas will not let him buy a house without my consent or without even checking my credit. So even though we were only trying to get one in Brian's name because his credit's a lot better than mine, he's the one with all the income and like he doesn't have as much debt, Texas will not allow you to be married and not add your spouse on there. So he's responsible for my debt. That's the way Texas does it. And so it's just kind of like one thing after another, I felt like, and I was just, but I mean, we were approved for a home loan and we were approved for a comfortable amount. And so we're just trying to do better this year within fixing stuff and just being better prepared, way better prepared. So yeah, if you ever thought about buying a house, don't worry so much about your score. If you have a good score, now start making sure you either find a better job that makes more money or pay off a lot of that debt still. So don't have any high credit card balances, anything like that. I feel like my base is looking so pretty today. So yeah, there has been something else that I have on my heart that I've really been wanting to talk about because I haven't talked about it since I made the video. 2-3 years ago, almost 3 years ago, for sure 2 years ago, about Brian and I making the conscious decision to leave our church that we were at. And it kind of happened once we moved into this house too. I don't know if you guys remember. If you're new, you wouldn't know, but I had made a video about the reason Brian and I had left the church. There was so much church hurt there, and a lot of it had to do with a lot of the members just not knowing any better or not even realizing that they were hurting. And I know in that video I kind of just generalized it, which made a lot of people at that church feel attacked. But then I was like, well, I was kind of stuck in a rock and a hard place within wanting to share that story, because had I said names or really singled people out, like a lot of people would have been upset that I did that. It would have kind of been assumed as like gossiping. But within generalizing it, a lot of people were like, well, you're just making it seem like everybody at that church was terrible. And no, that's not what I meant. I did not mean everybody at that church hurt me. What I meant was there was a lot of manipulation going on with a lot of the members and leaders of the church, and like you just didn't realize it, or a lot of things that Brian and I just didn't agree with it. Like there's pretty much one time where and I didn't want to get back into it, but like one big reason that we left, because I don't want people to think like it was just people or members, because it wasn't a lot of the members, it was a lot of the leadership going on, I guess you could say. And one thing I didn't agree with was that we were having like, because Brian and I were leaders in the church that we used to go to, not the one we currently go to, which we have also been at for 2 years now. We're going on 2 years. It'll be 2 years in November, I believe. So, anyways, so at our old church, we were having a leadership meeting. And this, I'm just saying this because this is one of the reasons, because it had a lot to do with our beliefs and what we were learning in the Word of God and what the church kind of wasn't willing to teach or even acknowledge. So I had said, you know, like just encouraging my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. And, you know, I just said, like, you know, make sure you're always putting God first, like doing what he says first. And, you know, like just kind of saying like everything after that will follow. Like, yes, honor your pastors, honor the elders, but always make sure you're first doing what God wants you to do. And the pastors were kind of just like, whoa, 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 like you can't just like bypass us and go straight to God. But like they would kind of teach that you, like, you know, like you didn't need a middle person to get to God. And because like that's kind of what religion tells you, like that's what Catholicism teaches you, is that like you have to go through your priest to ask for forgiveness or to confess your sins, when in reality true Christianity, true following God and living for him, is that Jesus was the bridge between us and God, and he came and fulfilled that. So I don't need another man to intervene for me and God. Like I don't need another man to answer to God, you know, like I don't need to answer to him before I answer to God, if that makes sense. And so like I just felt like in that moment they were kind of telling me like them before God. So even if God was telling me, you know, I don't think you should do that, but they were telling me they thought I should do that, that I should listen to them before I listen to God, was how I felt. I'm not saying that's how they meant it. I'm saying that's how I felt, and it didn't sit right with my spirit. And so Brian and I had talked about it, and so it was just a long time coming. But I wanted to say, you guys, like, if you do ever want to leave your church, like, your spirit will let you know, one, if you're just being offended because they're teaching truth, or two, if you're being offended because it is truly something that's going against God. And honestly, that is why I had chosen, because Brian wanted to leave way before I did. Like, he wanted to leave way before I did, and I was like, no, like, you're just, you know, being a hard-headed wife wanting to control my husband and where we worshiped at, not allowing my husband to lead our family spiritually, which was wrong on my part. And then, like, God just kept showing me, like, you know, like, your husband's right. And then he wasn't ready to leave because we had been given all these obligations to the church, and I was ready. It was just, y'all, it was so much. And it was just like, your spirit will let you know, because, like I said, especially if you're married and let's say your husband just isn't feeling it, like, listen to your husband, because God will always talk to your husband before he talks to you, because your husband is the head of the house. Your husband is who God works through the most. Can he talk to you? Yeah. But, like, when it comes to spiritual decisions and where the family needs to be led, God's usually going to talk to the husband first. And he, like, God uses me all the time to maybe correct Brian or set boundaries or things like that. But ultimately, where we're going to choose to worship, where we're going to choose to fellowship, like, your husband will usually be spoken to first. And I was ignoring that. And I was ignoring that from Brian for such a long time. So, but anyways, the point of me saying that is that God will let you know. And you also have to do a heart check too. Like, am I just offended because they're correcting something that feels good to me? Am I just offended because I don't want to stop doing something they're telling me that goes against God? Or are they teaching something that does not line up with the Word of God? Ultimately, it came down with a lot of things just not lining up with the things of God that my husband and I were learning. And whenever we would try to talk to them, it's like we were in the wrong. Like, because we didn't go to Bible, any form of, hey, good job, y'all get out, y'all go to y'all's room, go play. Okay! Like, because we didn't go to Bible college, like, we didn't know any better. Like, we can't correct because, or we can't enlighten or share because we didn't have a degree that said we went to a specific Bible college. Which, by the way, that is not how God works. God chooses to ordain who he chooses to ordain. He chooses to reveal things to whom he chooses to reveal things, whether we went to school to be taught by a man or not, because ultimately God is our teacher, and he has given us the textbook of life, which is the scriptures. And if we're living by that, we're following that, we're deciphering it for what God has said that it is, like, you cannot tell me that I'm wrong within the way that I want to live my life, or with the way I don't want to live my life, because it don't line up to the words of God. Like, it may not line up with the way that you want me to live, but if it lines up with the way God wants me to live, like, of course I'm not going to listen to my pastor if I feel God leading me one way but you want me to go a different direction. But I know that this is God telling me to go this way. I'm going to do what God tells me to do. And for you to tell me not to do what God tells me to do is kind of like, so what are you teaching? What do you believe? Like, do you believe that you should be my God and then God is my God? I don't know. But yeah, it was just a lot of different things. And I'm not just saying that about the church that I went to, but I've seen it in a lot of different churches, a lot of different people that talk to me about things. And like, I, even other churches that I've attended, and I'm just like, y'all, like, the Bible is not some self-help book. The Bible is not some, and God is not some genie where you can go and tithe and God makes it all better. He's not a genie. He's not a slot machine. Like, you don't make three wishes or do three things and God's like, hey. Like, I don't know, just so much. And that's what progressive Christianity wants you to do. It's like they want you to treat God like as this genie that's here only to grant your wishes and commands. But they do, like, they want you to treat God like he's only here to grant your wishes and your commands and for you to do, like, because if they can get you to do that, so if a church can get you to tithe to that church and get you to believe, like, you know, you're supposed to tithe because if you don't tithe, you're robbing God. And I'm just like, okay, so first of all, who's the church? So you tell me I'm supposed to tithe to the church. I'm supposed to make an offering to the church, which is something that I love about our current church. So you're telling me I'm supposed to do all these things for the church, but who does the Bible say the church is? Because he doesn't say it's one specific building. He doesn't say it's one specific church family. No, the church is the body of Christ. Anybody who chooses to worship God for who he is and follow his statutes and limitations and live by that, that's the church. So if you're at, so if you're watching this and you live in Timbuktu, but you choose to worship God the way I worship him, you are my sister in Christ. You need help. You are the church. I help you. It's not just confined to a building. And so even then, if you're giving all your money and all of your last to the church, and there is a brother or sister in Christ who may not attend the same church you do, but they need help, now what? Now you can't help them. And 9 times out of 10, your church is choosing who they're going to help. And it's not going to be, you know, at least most churches with progressive Christianity and like this whole prosperity teaching and, you know, like this whole live how you want, God will forgive you anyways. That's not the gospel. That's not what the scriptures say. That's not who God is. That's what salvation is. And I say it over and over again. Salvation is not just coming to God and being like, oh, I love you. You love me. I can do whatever I want because I'm forgiven. No, salvation means your sins are forgiven. So that way you don't have to face the wrath of God when the time comes. Because the wrath of God is not meant for everyone. It wasn't meant. Okay, let me say this. You're an aunt, you're an uncle, you're a mom, you're a dad. And I say that in the sense of that we are God's children. Now you're telling me you would not feel wrath watching people come against your niece, your child that you care for? You would not feel wrath seeing your child be molested, raped, beaten, forced to do drugs? You would not feel wrath because of that? You would not want to punish these people? And, you know, it's people that know better. It's people that understand that it's wrong, but they do it anyways for their own selfish pleasure. You can't tell me you wouldn't feel wrath. And that's what God sees day in, day out, because God is omnipresent, which means he's everywhere at one time, seeing everything, witnessing everything. So every murder, every rape, every abortion, every child that's left unfed, every child that's neglected, every woman that's beat, every man that gets wrongfully accused and beaten. Like, God is witnessing all of this, and he's witnessing it in people that know better and that know, and it's just like, who punishes them? And that's why the Bible says, you know, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Because those people do have to answer. And a lot of the times, like, because we are human, and because we have a sinful nature, we want to punish those people. We want them to feel the pain that we should think that they should feel. When ultimately, like, spending eternity in hell, burning for the rest of eternity, which eternity means never ending, never dying, never fading, I think is the best punishment a serial killer could have. Of that does not find God, that does it for their pleasure, a serial rapist. Like, I think that is the best punishment that could be given, because it's never ending. And I'm not saying that I'm perfect, you guys. And I was definitely wrong in the way that I made that video the last time. But that's why I just wanted to update and clarify a few things for you guys. And also, like, just encourage you guys too. Like, you don't have to stay at a church that you don't feel you're called to be at. Like, you don't have to stay at a church that you do not agree with what they're teaching. You are free to leave. You are free to go find truth. That is the beautiful thing about the Word of God, is that whenever you're in it, whenever you're learning it for yourself, whenever you're not only allowing yourself to be fed by man, but you are feeding yourself, is that God will reveal so many things to you. God will show you so many things. And so that's one thing. If there's anything that I've learned in my walk with God, is to do your own reading, do your own research and everything, whether it's biblical, whether it's political, like, do your own research in everything. And do your own research in everything is what I'm trying to say. But yeah, that's probably the main thing that I've learned, is to do your own research and everything. Don't only allow yourself to be fed by the media, by your pastors, by your mom, by your dad, by your best friend. Like, feed yourself. Learn to feed yourself. Learn to grow and nurture yourself. Like, you can't depend on somebody else for that, because if you're depending on somebody for that, 9 times out of 10, they like you where they have you, and they want to keep you. Dang, I was not even done with my makeup. And they want to keep you there. But that's why the Bible says the truth shall set you free. A lot of people think that that's meaning literally, like you're not in bondage and you shouldn't be a slave and this, I don't agree with slavery, let me say that before my words get twisted, but a lot of people think it's speaking on that aspect, but it's truly speaking spiritually and mentally. Like once you learn the truth will set you free from the bondage of men's teaching, the bondage of men's ways, the bondage of the world's ways. You are set free from that once you know truth. And that's what the Bible means when it says the truth shall set you free. Because so many people quote that and they are not putting it in the context, which in the way the Lord meant for it to be taken. But all right, you guys, that is it for today's look. I hope that you guys enjoyed the little shop my stash and loved how the makeup look came out. I don't know why I've been so like drawn to cool tones, but I just have, and it came out really cute. I kind of really love it. A lot more intense than I wanted it to be. I should have not used the deep brown hair. I should have just did this and then did some of these two and just built this one up. But it's still cute nonetheless. Like I said, a little bit more intense than I wanted, but that's like personal preference for the look that I was going for. Probably could have also went without the wing liner. So yeah, hope that you guys enjoyed chatting with me today. Let me know. What do you think? Like, do you think a lot of the scripture is misinterpreted and taught to fit a certain agenda? Or do you agree with a lot of what's being taught today? I don't know. Let me know. So I love you guys. But always remember that Jesus loves you more. If you haven't already, please go ahead and give me a thumbs up. Also, hit that subscribe button. And I will see you guys in my next video. Bye, guys. Mwah.